epidemiological investigations. All epidemiological investigations involve data collection, processing, and analysis. In general, the more organized those functions are, the task will be easier to accomplish. The first step in any epidemiological investigation is collection of data. Investigations can be either qualitative, quantitative, or combination of those two approaches. Qualitative investigations are dealing with the ecology of disease, including the distribution, mode of transmission, and maintenance of infectious disease, and are investigated by field observation. So we have to go outside to collect the data. Quantitative investigation involves measurement of events, the number of cases of disease, and therefore are expressed in numerical values or data which can be later analyzed. Quantitative investigation includes surveys, monitoring and surveillance, epidemiological studies, modeling, and disease control programs. In order to create an effective control program of any disease occurring in any population requires studying and understanding of disease frequency and geographical distribution. Requirement for that information can be based on the demands required by the nature of disease. So its different approach is in slow or rapid spreading disease. The requirements may be put forward by importing countries in terms that animals have to be free from certain disease, which has to be proved in the International Animal Health Certificate. Furthermore, the requirements may be put by the process related to the improvement of national health status, such as brucellosis and tuberculosis control or eradication programs. And finally, those demands can be put by the competent authority or in this case veterinary services for monitoring of public health. In this case, we can give example of listeria or Escherichia coli monitoring and surveillance systems. In case of very rapidly spreading disease, like foot and mouth disease and blue tongue, it is most important for information about the appearance of disease to be available as soon as possible. So the success of control measure depends on the outcome of race between the infectious factor and implemented measures. The outcome is directly affected by ever-present lagging from the initial case to the first implemented measure. So for successful fighting of the disease, the countries must establish the good passive surveillance system, which consists mainly of the private veterinary station or veterinary inspection on the field and the competent authorities. In case of more slowly spreading disease like tuberculosis and brucellosis, there is no such urgent of rapid passing of transfer of information. There is no need of daily reporting of bovine tuberculosis, but from the other hand, it's essential when dealing with the foot and mouth disease outbreak. And the information about daily occurrence of diseases is it's very important. For moderate contagious disease, reporting at regular intervals, weekly and monthly, it's sufficient. However, when dealing with disease with a high case fatality rate, such as listeriosis and anthrax, it's very important that any increase of incidence of disease is rapidly detected to be able to react quickly and to prevent the further human losses. In this respect, for highly contagious disease, a permanent surveillance system is required, capable of detecting an initial case at any point of time and then of monitoring of day-to-day progress of the disease. For moderate contagious disease with a high case fatality rate, such a surveillance system is also required. In case of disease which is less transmissible and have low case fatality rate, less intensive surveillance system is required. The international surveillance reporting tools such as ADNS of OIE and ADNS of European Union are based on above mentioned logic. Surveys. A survey is a research method used for collecting data from a predefined group of animals to gain the information about disease or condition of interest, whether it's milk yield, weight gain, production of wool, eggs, and so on. Surveys can be taken on a sample or the frame of the population or as a census, which examines all animals in the population. Designing and implementing a census is quite a labor and financial demanding activity. Therefore, the censuses are usually combined with some other activities if they exist in the country, and usually they are combined with the routine checking for tuberculosis or blood collection for brucellosis. The other possibility is to carry out the survey on a sample of the population. In this case, is to be taking in consideration that the statistical validity of the sample and the precision required, which ultimately define the required sample size. The estimation of the sample size will be discussed later in the course. So the surveys could be cross-sectional if they are occurring at a particular point of time, or can be longitudinal studies which records events over a longer period of time. A special case of survey is screening used for the identification of undetected case of disease using rapid test or examination. The aim is to separate the animals which most probably don't have the disease with the animals which probably have it. The screening tests are not definitive. They have to be, the positive case has to be examined with some confirmatory disease. Monitoring and surveillance. Monitoring and surveillance system collect information on animal health and disease which are otherwise unavailable. The system may use part of it, existing database as a passive data collection, or may require on-spot data collection as active data collection. It is very important that the data requirements are clearly identified before the data collection begins to avoid unnecessary wasting of time and efforts. The first rule of epidemiology is trash in and trash out, which means that if we don't provide the good quality as input data, we cannot expect that the results will be also good data. We will get also bad data as output data. So the information collected usually use spatial and temporal trends of disease or disease characteristics in time and space dimension in order to predict the disease occurrence, and based on that information to create epidemiologically and economically effective and efficient solution for disease and or control eradication programs. Monitoring is by definition routine observation on health, productivity and environmental factors, and the recording and transmission of those observations. Animal disease monitoring describes ongoing efforts directed to assist the health and disease status of the given population. In simple words, the monitoring system is used for confirm that everything is fine and to warn if something gets wrong. Some monitoring, part of the routine monitoring activities are milk recording, reports from the slaughterhouses, reports from the border post, and so on. Out of the individual number of animals might be recorded, this is usually not in the reports, because for monitoring reports we usually get the summary reports without details. From the other hand, surveillance is more intensive form of data collection and monitoring. It includes the collection and interpretation of a data collecting during monitoring programming for both infectious and non-infectious diseases. The ID of infected animals is recorded when it's possible in order to trace forward and backward all the contacts with that particular animal. The recording of tuberculosis lesions is in slaughterhouse, which subsequent tracing of animals is a good example of surveillance. Monitoring and surveillance may include all national herd or several animals, farm, villages, municipalities, livestock markets, slaughterhouses, milk processing plants, veterinary practices or laboratories as a sentinel units, which will be regularly checked on early the disease present using statistically valid procedures. Such a system may incorporate diagnostic tests for disease detection and determination of disease freedom. The main questions to be answered before constructing a formal monitoring and surveillance system are as follows. So we will take the example of tuberculosis or brucellosis control program in order to be better understandable. Now, the first question is, what is the major objective of the monitoring or surveillance and why? So in case of brucellosis or tuberculosis, first we want to know whether the disease is present in the some area or in the whole country. And when we detect that it's present, how are we going to react it? The second question is what type of sentinel station are needed. Now again, for both brucellosis and tuberculosis monitoring, we need veterinary station on the field, which will collect the data. We need the competent authority who will design the system and analyze the system and also pay on the end. We need inspectors to control them, and in case of the brucellosis we also need the laboratory. The next question is how those stations are selected. So they can be selected based on the disease specific criteria. For example, we don't need laboratories for tuberculosis. Then it's more country specific, and it depends of the organization of the veterinary services. Those stations might be selected with a public tender, with a directly contact, and so on. The next question is how the region and units incorporated in the system are selected. So usually there is two type of selections. One is scientific and the other is economical. So we might usually design the perfect system, but when we come to decision maker, they say, look, we don't have enough money, so we have to work with restricted budget. Restricted budget means that we will have to decrease a little bit the precision of our system. The next question is to what extent the representatives needed and why. It also depends of the risk and on the impact that the risk have of the animal population. So the representatives, it's mainly related with the risk and the impact which case, but also again with the finances that we have to fulfill our task. The next question is how the number of samples are determined and what types of samples are required. So it's also determined by the nature of disease and by the nature of control program that we are going to implement. For screening and monitoring, we need less samples, but for surveillance and control measures, we need much larger number of samples. The next question is how reliable are diagnostic tests that will be used? So, for example, if we are in the phase of controlling the disease, the samples has to have both good sensitivity and sensibility and sensitivity. But in the later case, when we are near to the eradication of the disease, it is crucial important that we find out every remained animal in the population. In this respect, we will use the laboratory test with high sensitivity, and we might even sacrifice some healthy animals, but which is crucial for the eradication program, that all remain infected animals are eliminated from the population, which might sometimes include and some healthy ones. The next question is how reliable is the expected information to be collected? So it depends. If we have good passive surveillance network, it's usually the best solution for collection of data. Active surveillance requires more labor, requires laboratory, and it's usually more expensive. The next question which has to be answered, what type of analytical methods should be used? And the last one, and also important, what are the expected costs of the program and what are the benefits? During all stages of monitoring and surveillance process, it must be provided that all aspects of the work and standardized. This must cover the data collected. So it's very important if clinical cases are involved, that insertion, that that they are very precisely defined. So let's give example of if we want to take information from the field about the temperature of the body temperature of the animal. So if we don't specify what kind of data we want, we might end with plenty of different answers. So you ask of just temperature and you put just small t in the field, so you might get the answers as yes, no, high, low, or you get the temperature expressed in Celsius. So you have five different data which is unstandardized, and you might work just with one that you required. So the next which has to be standardized, how the data are going to be collected, whether the samples will be taken, how the samples will be taken, what kind of samples do we need. So you don't want to end with the blood samples, tissue samples, urine. If you don't specify it, you can get all kind of data. So the next what have to be standardized is the laboratory examination. The most to standardize the laboratory test is when we use the valid laboratory test which are accredited. So you just ask for accreditation of the laboratory test and you know that your method is standardized. And the final question that has to be answered is how the data are collected and collated. So whether how the data is collected and how they are collected with each other. In majority of cases, providing some training exercises and exercises for working on the field, it's essential. This will ensure that the people remain motivated, and most important, they know what to do.